Welcome to Lot 76 Cars. My name's Simon and today we're back at Bicester for the Bicester Assembly, the Naughty Naughties as it's called. Some great cars here to see. Let's go and have a look at them and let's try and have a chat with a few of the owners. So first up is this E90 BMW. It is in actual fact an Alpina, so built in small numbers by Alpina. This is the D3, so packing, my memory serves me right, about 214, 215 horsepower from a diesel engine even. Eminently usable. Love those Alpina wheels. Alpinas really are special. Each one of the cars is numbered. For me, I absolutely love the Alpina stripes on this one, so shout out to Hell's Car Cult. I think that's an Instagram handle. That's really nice, isn't it? What an eminently usable car. So this Mercedes-Benz R230 SL was collected new from the factory in Bremen back in 2003 by the owner. It's got the Milli Miglia stickers on the side in reference to Stirling Moss's victory. And this particular car, so the owner's had it for 20 years now, it's done 239,000 miles. And it's in pretty great condition, actually. So viewers of the channel might recall that we've seen this Seicento Sporting Arbath once before. It's absolutely immaculately prepared. The owner tells me he's not bought the ramps to show us how well prepared it is underneath. He bought this from an old guy, and I'm going to get Ruben, who owns the car, to have a chat with us in a second, tell us a bit more. You've got a light yellow with this car, haven't you, really? Fair bit of yellow there. But it does look immense, doesn't it? Apparently these are becoming quite collectible as well. You know, once relatively street furniture, and even in their home market, relatively rare. So let's have a chat with Ruben and find out a bit more. So I'm here with Ruben, who's going to tell us a bit more about this Seicento Sporting Arbath. It's quite an unusual car, got a great history with it, and he's done absolutely loads of work to it. So Ruben, over to you. Tell us a bit more about the car, please.
So this car was been sat outside without being used for, I would say, about 4 years. Spent those 4 years riding past it and walking and thinking I would like to own it one day. And managed to trace the owner. In fact, due to that neighbor that everyone knows, she knows everything. So the old man said, well, I'll only sell it to you if you try to rescue it. I got one back home, so I love these cars, and they're quite unusual. That's why I think it's worth saving, because it's a bit of history. And I did all the work myself, and it's still a work in progress. It's never finished. And that's it. It's been saved. I've done all the work myself, and I think people should try and rescue all these cars instead of scrapping them all the time.
Indeed. And it's a pretty unusual car, because you mentioned you've had to get parts from all over Europe in this spec with ABS even?
Yeah, it got ABS, power steering, everything. I had to get bits over from Germany, from Poland, you name it. Where there was, we had to get it. And of course, import taxes now and everything. But it's all worth it in the end. When you like the car, you like to spend the money and get it nice and sorted so people can appreciate it and you appreciate it yourself.
Yeah, thanks Ruben, appreciate that.
No worries. Thank you very much. Thank you, have a good day. Cheers, enjoy.
Thank you. Now, aren't these probably the most usable of the Imprezas? To me anyway, the five-door sort of semi-estate body on this one. I'm not sure it's a full estate in terms of the space in the back, but what an incredibly usable car. Now this one's actually for sale, so somebody's got the opportunity for $7,500 to buy that one, and it looks to be a very, very tidy motor, doesn't it? So the MGF, which was launched in 95, was replaced by the TF in later years. With the changed front styling and also the deletion, I think, of hydrogas, and replaced of a normal spring setup. This one's in great condition. They're not appreciated as much as they should be. They do drive particularly well, and they're absolutely immense value for money at the moment. buy a good one, keep it, and I can't see you losing money on it. So I hope you're enjoying the video here from Bicester Heritage. Plenty more cars to come. If you do, then it would really help the channel if you'd click the subscribe button and put notifications on to be told when my latest videos are becoming live, and would really appreciate the support. Thank you. VW's booted version of the Golf had a number of names over the years. It was called Jetta, it was called Vento, or in this incarnation, it was called Bora. This one's a particularly nice example. Not all survive as well as this one. And it's got some pretty tasty looking wheels on it, hasn't it? That looks pretty immense, doesn't it? Some subtle changes, like that sort of carbon type rear spoiler on it there. Modified but subtly done. Looks great, doesn't it? Very nice facelift, second generation Lotus Elise. I believe part of the development costs of this were paid for with the collaboration on the VX220 with GM Group. I think there's one of those here as well. Great looking cars, and values, particularly for the pre-facelift cars, have gone absolutely through the roof. Lovely, isn't it? So for Mercedes fans, and packing a 5-litre engine, is a really fast estate car, this C55 C-Class estate. Really sort of an iron fist in a velvet glove. Masses of power, loads of space. Whatever's in the back, the dogs are in the back, they're going to travel at immense speed, aren't they? But that's lovely, isn't it? So these first generation CLK convertibles are seldom seen in such great condition as this particular car. It's a lovely blue with a blue hood. Can't understand why these cars are still worth so little. Later on, the car got an extensive redesign, and the next generation, the rear light treatment was actually changed. This has got the earlier rear lights, that squarer rear lights, and to be honest with you, I prefer those. So Mitsubishi, with a fantastic rallying heritage and sadly a brand now gone from the UK but not from Europe, produced this great looking Lancer. I mean, what's not to like about those fins? There's not just one fin, there's multiple fins on the back. It's got a rear spoiler that probably needs planning permission, but I bet it's an incredible drive, isn't it? Now, is this the ultimate 5 Series? It's an E39, one of my favourite cars. E34's pretty close by, but this one's an M5, so it's got those lovely alloy wheel designs. I'm sort of not quite sure what they're called, but manual transmission as well in this one, which is really makes it an involving drive, I guess. Great to see that here today. I do like those. Now, some great cars here today. We're going to walk past that Porsche because my eye has been drawn to something in the distance. Now, it's a Mark 1 Audi TT. What a car, translated from the concept with very little changes. Looking from the rear spoiler, or at the rear spoiler rather, it does look to me like it's the 3.2 litre version. But what does catch my eye is, look at the colour. I don't know if the camera's picking it up, but it's in a gold colour. I have never seen a gold Audi TT. If you know what the colour is, put me out of my misery and stick it in the comments. Yeah, it is a 3.2, I was right on that. That is absolutely lovely, isn't it? What a rare looking car. What a rare colour indeed. So the V8 Vantage really takes us into Aston Martin's volume production period. Built these, I think it was a 4.3 litre engine. This is a manual gearbox as well, which is obviously quite a desirable format. And they are pretty cars, aren't they? It's got to be said that they've got a lot going for them in the looks department. So in 2018, Porsche GB took on a project to restore a number of cars from each generation of Porsche to an almost better than new standard. So this one is an early-ish Boxster. The paint finish alone, this particular paint was a £40,000 option on one of the other models, which was the 918 Spider. And this one is an absolutely one-off car. It must have had thousands spent on it. So easy to walk by that and mistake that for just another Boxster. But it's absolutely immense, isn't it? Let's just have a quick look at the interior. Interior doesn't give the game away that much, but it is lovely, isn't it? So this very shy and retiring looking Mustang doesn't shout its power. It absolutely screams it, doesn't it? 5.4 litre supercharged, 750 horsepower. That is all we need to know. And it does look pretty immense, doesn't it? So the BMW Z3 in this generation, it is sometimes unfairly called the clown shoe because of the styling. The styling was a bit divisive at the beginning. I think it's grown on everybody. In the M3 format, I think you've got something like 3.2 litres to play with, M3 engine, I think, in that car. It's a lovely colour, isn't it? This sort of, don't know if the camera picks this up, this lovely dark green metallic. Sadly, although it might look like it's got rear seats, it doesn't, but it does have some decent usable luggage area in the car, doesn't it? So this Aston Martin DB12, not quite a modern classic for a few years to come, but every Aston Martin's probably worth videoing, isn't it? Look at those lovely styling features there, how the wing flows into that wheel arch almost seamlessly. Beautiful pano roof on there. And look at that rear light treatment there. They really know how to style their cars, don't they? I think Marek, his designer there, has done a great job with that one, hasn't he? Now, no apologies necessary, I think, for showing you another E39. This is a 535i, so probably a bit more accessible in terms of price. It's an automatic, this one. Absolutely lovely. Love that blue colour. These are great cars, aren't they? As you can probably tell, I'm a fan of the E39s. I just think they've got just enough tech to be still usable day to day. Keep up with modern traffic, more than usable. What else do you need than an E39? So here we've got a Renault Clio V6, rear mid-engined or mid-engined. This is one of the later cars. I think these were built by Alpine at the Dieppe factory. The earlier cars were built by Tom Walkinshaw on behalf of Renault. It's got some incredible features. I mean, there's plenty of cooling there. That the back of the car is all engine, basically. Seats have been junked. Massively, massively wide rear track on those. Subjectively, not actually that hugely fast. I think they're maybe just about over 200 and something horsepower. I'll try and put it on screen. But honestly, what's not like to like about that? Looks like it's just come off a rally stage and it's a Group B rally car. Immense, isn't it? So this Mark V Fiesta is an ST. Now, many people called it the ST150. In fact, it wasn't actually called the 150. It's got 150 horsepower. It's got a 2-litre engine, so you can imagine it's probably got a fair bit more torque. Not massively overstressed. These are becoming collectible, and quite rightly so. It's got those lovely branded ST bucket seats. This one's got the stripes on the side, which for me are well worth having, but that's just personal opinion. But these look great value as classics, and with 150 horsepower on tap, that's not to be sniffed at, really, is it? So here we've got a TVR Sagaris with the 4-litre Almelin designed Speed 6 engine. Actually an engine that was only ever used and designed and supplied to TVR. Quite risky for a small manufacturer to commission one of those. It's got, I think, 195 mile an hour top speed, where permissible, wherever that is, I don't know, but maybe somewhere on Earth. Great design features. Look at those sort of gills on the side. Only TVR could produce something so incredibly outrageous as this. But look at the rear spoiler. The rear spoiler, helpfully, is clear, so you can see the road behind. That's good, isn't it? That's nice, isn't it? This E46 BMW M3, and actually it's the more desirable manual. The SMG gearbox gets a few mixed reviews. Some people think they can improve it with software, but the manual is absolutely the collector's one to have, isn't it? So a bit further down the Renault pecking order with the sporting Clios is this lovely Clio Sport. So this one's from, what, 2010, looking at the plate. Colour doesn't look like a wrap, it does look like a factory colour. To be honest, it looks like paint rather than a wrap. And it's an immense looking car. Got the obligatory rear spoiler on the back. That looks like it could be quite a lot of fun, doesn't it? So the E60 BMW 5 Series, I think it's the fifth generation of the 5 Series, did actually divide opinion at the time, and maybe still does now. This was designed by Chris Bangle, and he brought to it a very different styling direction to BMW, and you'll probably see in a contemporary 7 Series as well, particularly from the rear. Not everybody can necessarily get on with that styling. Maybe eventually it will find its niche. But the one thing for this particular car, it's in lovely condition. It is the M5, and got some pretty immense wheels on, isn't it? That's lovely. I must admit, it just seems to work in that colour with those wheels and that rear spoiler. It looks pretty good. So the R53 Mini was launched in 2001, and relatively early into the life cycle, they released a more sporting version. So it's the Cooper S, but it's with a supercharger. These are becoming quite interesting cars. The R53 particularly, some people rate the R53 far higher than the subsequent cars. So the original Mini was designed by revered designer Frank Stevenson, and he probably just about got it right, where the versions now look a little bit more ungainly, but that looks lovely, doesn't it? Now, not quite a classic, but it is rare, and this is what I was saying about how the Minis developed, not necessarily in the direction everybody likes, but this is the low volume series GP, the latest GPs. Just try and show you those arch extension splitters, I don't know what you call them. I mean, they're perhaps a bit vulnerable for parking down Tesco's, but plenty of rear spoiler. In the rear spoiler stakes, that's right up there, isn't it? Well, interesting. So there's no mistake in a TBR Tuscan from that incredible looking front light treatment there. As many people know, you actually open the door, there is no door handle, you've got a button there under the mirror. Interior looks quite a nice place to be with all that knurled aluminium. They do look incredible. You think, how many years since TBR ceased production? And this looks almost futuristic now. So I think elsewhere in the video we've got the facelifted or Series 2 Elise. This is Vauxhall's version, using a GM engine sold under the Vauxhall and Opel brand, I think, as the Opel Speedster and the Vauxhall the EX220, turbo and non-turbo. Still a pretty special car. Got a lot of the attributes of the Elise, but certainly much more accessible in terms of price. Not sure if they actually changed anything of the side treatment of this car, whether they're easier to get into than an Elise. But certainly means business, that one, doesn't it? So surprisingly, just 450 Honda NSXs were actually sold in the UK from the beginning to end of production. This one's an early-ish car, and it's an automatic. Still got 270 brake horsepower, which in fairness is more than enough. We'll just try and take a look in the engine bay if we can. That's where that engine resides. These brought all together a Honda approach to supercars, which meant usability, desirability, but in actual fact reliability. So a lot less temperamental than contemporary supercars, and supposedly developed with the help of Ayrton Senna. So what's not to like? Now, another unusual Audi TT is this cherry red pearlescent Mark 1. It's a 180, it's got the single exhaust at the back. Owner's got some more work planned on it, but I have to say it's in a pretty good starting point. And that colour does make it really, really unusual, doesn't it? So many of these were sold in silver, and it's a breath of fresh air to see something like this cherry red metallic. So we've got an R53 Mini again, yes, but it is one of the original very limited GP series based on the supercharged cars with that scoop at the front. These are numbered, here we go. This is number 609. I think they produce maybe 1,000 cars, something like that. This is probably the one to have. Looks nice, doesn't it? Now, outside the hangar at Bicester, there's also quite a lot of other cars in the overflow parking. Can't quite fit in the hangar. Some of those, as you can see behind me. Let's take a look around those and check out what they've got to offer. So the seventh generation Civic grew quite a lot in size, so the Jazz could fit beneath it. Quite a tall design. This is obviously the three-door, and it's the revered Type R with that massively high revving engine, that very high, you see it on camera, that high position for the gear lever. A lot of these have been ragged within an inch of their life, but thankfully this one hasn't, and it does look in pretty good order, doesn't it? So the E46 Imola Blue Club's in town. Well, if you fancy a change, we can offer you a carbon black, jet black, or a silver one if you want. So it's great to see one of the original XR4Is, one of the few cars in the range, in fact I think the only car, to have that side window treatment that was unusual. There was another side window with a single rear window rather than that split two. It's got the double rear spoiler on that one as well. And these are apparently starting to become quite desirable. 2.8 litre engine. Continuing the very random nature of this show is a Renault 5 Campus. Now, I think the 5 Campus, or the Supersonic, the Super 5 as it became known, ran for some while as a sort of classic or budget entry to the range. I think even there was some overlap with the Clio. I'm sure my subscribers who know more about French cars than me might put me right. It is rather nice, isn't it? Original dealer sticker in the back. Gee, what would that make it? $89.90? Lovely. So long-term subscribers and viewers of the channel might recognise this lovely C124 series coupe. The reason being, I drove this one earlier in the year and it's been one of the most successful videos I've done. So check that one out. Fabulous pillarless coupe design, and Kevin, the owner, has got the windows open to have the full effect, even though it's absolutely freezing here today. Great to see that. So there can't be many cars have got a pedigree connects them to a fighter jet. This is a Saab Viggen. It's named after the Viggen fighter that Saab Aero actually produced. 230 brake horsepower, I think less than 5,000 units produced. I remember this one being for sale. It's from Hagstrom Saab over in East Anglia. Well, they are absolute legends as Saab specialists. And this one is a beauty, isn't it? Usable, it's a five-door. You wouldn't think it had got 230 brake horsepower on tap. And great to see it in the regular parking here. So based on the Rover 400, then 45 shaped platform, in the Phoenix 4 days of MG Rover, they developed this vehicle, this MG ZT 180, with the 2.5 litre engine. It's a car that I drove in automatic format. These were manuals. I think it's the only way you could get a manual in this vehicle. And this was developed, I believe, by Peter Stevens, the styling was, also with the support of Harris Mann. The recently departed, much-loved designer Harris Mann did some work on this project as well, apparently. This one is in really good condition. Not everyone survives. A lot of these have been raced and dragged to within an inch of their life, but this one hasn't. The paintwork is absolutely immense, isn't it? And apparently they really, really are a driver's car. Geomon Cars and a few other people absolutely rate them, and I can understand that. So from the same period as the MGZT, and proclaiming it's not just a car, it's an MGZR. Well, it is. It's a lovely MGZR. I'm not sure what to brake horsepower, whether it's the revered 160s. Nevertheless, these were sweet, sweet handling cars. And the bubble-shaped Rover on which they're based is actually now starting to get quite a bit more attention and becoming quite a bit more collectible. That's great, isn't it? So here's a couple of rare ones. We've got the Renault RS Twingo, and next to it we've got a Phase 2 one. Apparently the first cars, the Phase 1 cars, ran for about 5 years, whether the, I think the Phase 2 ones here to the left only ran for about a year, which is really unusual. There's one of these for sale at the moment, I think, at a Silverstone version of one. He's at Chop's Garage, if you fancy that. He's got a channel on YouTube. Great, lovely little sporty hatches, aren't they? So this Renault Laguna belongs to Shine Retiring Mr. Wig, another YouTuber, so shout out to you, my friend. I think I've met him at a previous event. I've not quite logoed my own car up and liveried it up to that level yet, but lovely to see a Renault Laguna. I'm sure these were the ones where they started with a key. They perfected a plastic key rather than a normal metal one, but yeah, there you have it, Mr. Wig, shout out to you. So thanks again for joining me on Lot 76 Cars at the fabulous Bicester Heritage Assembly, one of the last shows of 2023. Hope you've enjoyed the content and the cars on display here today. If you did, then please like, share, subscribe, and I'll see you on the next one. Thanks for watching.